Good evening, everyone. If you'd please take your seat, we're going to begin. My name is Dorothy Hodson. I'm the past president of the African Studies Association, and I'd like to welcome all of you on behalf of the ASA. I want to, again, give thanks especially to our program co-chairs, Bill Mosley and Benjamin Lawrence, and our local arrangement committee co-chairs, Alem Hailu and Eve Ferguson and Carl Levin. This is the Bashorun MKO Abiola Lecture, and it's indeed my pleasure and honor to be able to introduce our speaker tonight, Dr. Achille Mbembe. And it really is truly a personal honor. I've been a deep fan of his work for many years, and you know, we've met occasionally, and so this is really an extraordinary opportunity. His lecture tonight is entitled Knowledge Futures and the State of the Humanities. Professor Mbembe was born in Cameroon, obtained his PhD in history at the Sorbonne in Paris, and a DEA in political science at the Institut d'Etudes Politiques in Paris. He was assistant professor of history at Columbia University, New York from 1988 to 1991, a senior research fellow at the Brookings Institute in Washington, D.C. from 1991 to 92, associate professor of history at the University of Pennsylvania from 92 to 96. He's a nomad, maybe that's why we identify. Executive director of Cadestria and Dakar, Senegal from 1996 to 2000. Also visiting professor at the University of California, Berkeley, and a visiting professor at Yale. He's written extensively on African history and politics, including La naissance du maquis dans le Sud Cameroun, from Paris, Kartala, and of course, On the Post-Colony, which was published in Paris in 2000 in French, and the English translation published by University of California, Berkeley in 2001. He is an extraordinary scholar with an acute political mind and theoretical sensitivity, and I'd like you to join me in welcoming him tonight.
I would like to thank Dorothy, the ASA, the board of directors, for their very kind and gracious invitation. I'm very happy to be here, and I deeply appreciate the opportunity I have been given to reconnect with so many old friends, some of whom I have not seen for a long time. I had the immense pleasure yesterday to listen to the beautiful lecture given by Peter Schirr. I also had a look at the program. It was enough to convince me that the study of Africa in America is alive, and it is in the hands of new generations of scholars whose eyes are clearly fixated on the future. And for all of that, I'm very grateful. The remarks I'm about to make are shaped in no small part, but not exclusively, by the turmoil in South African academy over the last 2 years. The experience of students' protests in South Africa has generated a very difficult debate about whiteness and the damage resulting from institutionalized racial hierarchies and violence, debates about what counts as knowledge and why, debates about whether academic institutions can be turned into spaces of radical hospitality, and if so, how, for whom, and under what conditions, or whether they are simply sites of reproduction of already existing relations of domination within society, debates about what we should do with institutions inherited from a cruel past, whether such institutions are reformable, or whether they should simply be decommissioned, or for that matter, literally burnt down in the hope that from the ashes, something new will eventually emerge. As you probably know, at the core of these events and at the core of this paradoxical hope for something radically new, something which is not simply a repetition of what we thought we got rid of, at the core of these events has been a renewed injunction to decolonize. Injunction to decolonize institutions, or for that matter, injunction to decolonize knowledge itself. And this has been happening in a context in which the country, South Africa, is undergoing a kind of Fanonian moment, a moment when new social protagonists enter the stage, convinced that almost everything must now fall. Colonial statues, fees, even the rain itself. As we all know, and Gugi was just here with us a few minutes ago, calls to decolonize are not new. In the 60s, 70s, and 80s, they were issued under different names, the most recognizable of which were Africanization, indigenization, or even endogenization. So far, and as far as Africa is concerned, the decolonizing injunction has mostly consisted in a critique of what we could call the colonial knowledge chain. It has mostly consisted in the denunciation of its deleterious effects on African society, culture, and psyche. To be sure, a lot of resources have been invested in the study of so-called indigenous knowledge systems, most of which could, in fact, be assembled under the rubric of ethno-knowledges, so tight are their connections with the politics of identity and ethnicity. But as I speak, we still do not have a precise idea of what a truly decolonized knowledge might look like. Nor do we have a theory of knowledge as such, which might compellingly underpin the African injunction to decolonize. And it seems to me that because of the absence of, among other things, such a theory of knowledge, the injunction to decolonize may be, at least for the time being, better understood as a compensatory act whose function, and here I'm widely speculating, is to heal what amounts to racial shame. So what I'm going to do is to make a series of observations precisely on that injunction to decolonize. I will then move on and make a series of remarks concerning the epistemic reconfigurations or shifts which are underway, shifts in relation to what nowadays counts as knowledge, how it is produced, who are its subjects, and what it is its main purpose. This will allow me, hopefully, to comment on the new cognitive assemblages, if not new knowledge formations, that are currently in the making. And finally, still have a little bit of time, I will offer a few remarks on what these new landscapes of knowledge entail for our concept of Africa and for the figure of the African scholar and the scholar of Africa as a scholar of the world and as a world scholar in this age of reinvention of differences and resegregation. So first of all, set of comments on the injunction to decolonize. Take, for instance, Ngugi and his now canonical Decolonizing the Mind, which was published in 1981. Of all the practical implications Ngugi draws from his programmatic statements, the most important is arguably the necessity for a curriculum reform. Crucial in this regard is, for him, the need to teach African languages. The idea clearly being that a decolonized university in Africa should put African languages at the center of its learning project. Ngugi probably assumes that language inevitably shapes knowledge, or in any case shapes what it is possible to know. He probably, I'm not sure whether he's in the room, so we can always ask him, he probably believes that language inevitably grounds knowledge in a particular culture and influences what we know, how we know it, what is it that we do not know. But, and that would be my argument with Ngugi, language alone cannot stand or compensate for the lack of a theory of knowledge as such. Another example is Paulin Huntongi, for whom decolonizing knowledge amounts to making sure that our African scientific activity is not externally oriented, is not intended to meet the theoretical needs of our Western counterparts and answer the questions they pose. Why? Because for him, to decolonize knowledge is to replace such vertical relations with what he calls horizontalism, which he understands as, and I quote him, an autonomous, self-reliant process of knowledge production and capitalization that enables us to answer our own questions and meet both the intellectual and the material needs of African societies, end of quote. Ngugi then goes on to make a clear distinction between discourses on or about Africa, which are coming from or are produced by Africans within Africa. In other words, the study of Africa by Africans in Africa. I do not know where this leaves the diasporas. And any other discourse on the same subject, but which might originate from somewhere else. So it seems to me that this structural lack of a theory of knowledge, a potentially fatal weakness of the decolonizing project, is also at the heart of South African late injunctions to decolonize. The willingness to debunk whiteness, the over-reliance on US-made theories, black feminism, queer theory, Afro-pessimism, theories of intersectionality, and the idea of the university as a public good might be the exceptions, but in its South African version, the new call to decolonize is not that different from what we might call Ngugi wa Thiong'o's 1981 program. So let me pause here and observe that I have already put forward a series of polemical statements, which I hope will help the conversation that will follow this. Now let me move on and make a different kind of case. The observations I have just made do not constitute sufficient ground for an outright repudiation of the decolonizing project. I mean, all that I said, and I could have said even more, does not disqualify, but is not enough to disqualify the decolonizing project. It's not enough because, after all, an uncompromising critique of the dominant Eurocentric academic model, the fight against what Latin Americans in particular call epistemic coloniality, that is, the endless production of theories that are based on European traditions, that critique is still necessary. It is necessary because, indeed, the present academic model, with its origins in the universalism of the Enlightenment, is exhausted. Boaventura de Sousa or Enrique Dussel, for instance, make it clear that knowledge can only be thought of as a universal, if it is by definition, quote, pluriversal. They have made it clear that too that at the end of the decolonizing process, we will no longer have a university. We will have what they call a pluriversity. A pluriversity is not merely the extension throughout the world of a Eurocentric model, presumed to be universal and now being reproduced almost everywhere thanks to commercial internationalism. By pluriversity, they understand a process of knowledge production that is open to, quote, epistemic diversity. And it is a process, therefore, that does not necessarily abandon the notion of universal knowledge for humanity, but it embraces such a notion via, I quote again, a horizontal strategy of openness to dialogue among different epistemic traditions. And within such a perspective, to decolonize the university is to reform it with the aim of creating a less provincial and more open critical cosmopolitan pluriversalism, a task that involves the refounding of our ways of thinking and a transcendence of our disciplinary divisions. Now, the point I want to make is that, in fact, such a refounding of our ways of thinking and such attempts at transcending our disciplinary divisions are, in fact, already happening. They are happening partly in response to a set of challenges and contestations. The disciplines which constitute the foundations of modern knowledge are currently facing, many of which, I should hasten to add, cannot be accommodated within the generic rubric of decolonization. If you want me to put it differently, you know, in other words, I would say that however important the decolonization project is missing onto a whole set of reorganizations that are going on. And in the remarks that follow, I want to point our attention on those otherwise critical shifts which we have to attend to if, as far as we are concerned, people interested in Africa, if we are to produce about Africa the kind of knowledge that is beneficial not only for the humanity at large, but for the living species at large, the humans, but also the non-humans, since that is the planetary challenge we are now facing. So the question is, how is it that we turn the African predicament into a truly planetary predicament? at a time when the world we live in is becoming smaller and smaller. So let me now go on. I can say one or two things about those challenges, some of which are of a political nature, as we see in South Africa, around the necessity to decommodify higher education, to democratize access to higher education, to allocate a substantial part of the wealth of the nation to those that sector. So some of them are political. They have to do with questions of justice and care. Others, other contestations, are of a generational nature, if only because massive cultural shifts are underway as we increasingly live our lives in reconfigured environments of intense informational stimuli. At the present, we might not yet fully understand the consequences of the fact that digital technologies have become tightly woven into the fabric of everyday life. But it's clear that a technologically enhanced rewiring of the brain is underway, especially among the younger generations. And if it is true that dealing with digital and computational media on an everyday basis entails significant neurological changes, then the assumptions we used to entertain about the humans and their relations to the world may no longer be entirely valid in relation to the kinds of self that is emerging among the younger generations. The argument I'm making is that an entirely different human being is emerging, and we can see it amongst ourselves, but more importantly, among the practices induced by the kind of environment we live in younger generations. And therefore, we can no longer think as if the human that is at the basis of the humanities social sciences project has remained exactly the same. So those challenges posed by the emergence of an entirely different human being are being taken care of, indeed, by some disciplines, and I'll talk about that in a minute. Some of the other challenges are institutional. Not so long ago, institutionalized knowledge used to be all that counted. It was an object to be taught in clearly circumscribed institutions and disciplines, and knowledge produced by the university, for instance, was bounded, restricted by organizational apparatuses. As a matter of fact, there is no boundary for any knowledge today. Extra-institutional knowledge is unbounded, it is uncontainable, and it is easily searchable. It is no longer so easily restricted by organizational apparatuses. Furthermore, to know nowadays requires the development of a range of new literacies required, for instance, by changes in writing, in reading, in forms of public presentation, in the capacity to interpret images or to work on a screen. And as a consequence, old knowledge platforms now appear dated, or in any case, are falling into obsolescence at a higher rate and pace. And yet other contestations are of a pedagogical nature, triggered as they are by new learning methods, devices, and publics. Traditional ways of teaching have been changing thanks to a range of new practices and methods enabled by digital environments. The sense nowadays is that everything can be searched and found. Various open learning platforms are increasingly created by the learners themselves, and such platforms do challenge the very notion of disciplinarity, how to think properly, the questions that are the right ones to ask, the right method to deploy in addressing those questions. All of this is going on, and it is not clear, at least in South Africa or parts of the continent, that the university as an institution is equipped enough to respond to these challenges, most of which will be with us for, as we can think, for the future. I don't even mention the contestations around the old vertical teacher-student relationship, which is increasingly replaced by the idea of a learning community, one in which the teacher gives away control and learning encompasses the total social experience of the students. All of that is with us. So as a result of, on the one hand, these contestations, and as a result of technological innovations, epistemic reconfigurations are underway in various disciplines and sub-disciplines. And some of these reconfigurations are, it seems to me, paving the way for the emergence of entirely new cognitive assemblages, if not new knowledge formations. I would now like to briefly comment on three such key transformations that have to do with the changing epistemological landscape. The first such transformation has to do with the fragmentation of the disciplines. Of course, one can say that fragmentation has always been part of the life of the disciplines. And in fact, disciplines and fields of studies have never been entirely fixed, neither in form nor in organization. They have always been continuously forming and transforming, sometimes merging, but never really progressing toward any general unity or truth. So to some extent, what is going on is far from new. And yet, we are clearly witnessing an acceleration of this process today. It has reached a level such that many are now wondering whether disciplines as such have become obsolete. Indeed, established disciplines do no longer correspond to or encompass the variety of fields of inquiry. There is, in other words, a profound disjuncture between the disciplinary taxonomies inherited from the 19th and 20th centuries and the proliferation of thematic imagination, the rhythm of the constitution of diverse subfields, to the point where today there is almost a journal for anything. You Google Duke University Press, Sage, there is a journal for anything, just like, I mean, there are churches for everybody. You just become your own pastor, you have your own church. It's a bit like that. So that is a transformation that will only accelerate. We will not go back. So it raises all kinds of questions about what are the disciplines? What are they based on? At a time when thematic imagination is running almost wild. So to link it up to the question of decolonization, if we want to have a proper theory of decolonization of knowledge, it has to attend to these major process of our times. It cannot only be replacing this scholar by the other. It has to attend to these epistemic reconfigurations I'm talking about. The second one, epistemic reconfiguration, has to do with the velocity of so-called turns. So the 80s were, as we all know, marked by the linguistic or cultural turn. Then historians, sociologists, and anthropologists, and even political scientists increasingly turned their attention to questions of language and identity, symbols and social constructions, leaving behind, at least they hoped, the quantifiable material explanations of the 60s and the 70s, a turn, in fact, that if we were to be rigorous, could be traced back even to the mid-60s with especially the works of Michel Foucault. Nowadays, many turns are happening simultaneously. It's not simply that, okay, I have my turn today and then the other waits and then his or her turn comes in. No, they are happening. You just have to turn and then turns are happening all the time. The affect turn, the new materialism turn, the ontological turn, the neuro turn, they're coming from all over. Now, some of the turns do not truly break new grounds, and nor do they last. Others are not real turns, real, the irony of real, since they do not affect deeper questions of epistemology or of method. In fact, they are part of a vast recycling and rebranding of disciplines that goes hand in hand with the creeping, at least for some of us, commodification of education. Now, of all the factors behind the proliferation of fields and subfields of inquiry and the velocity of the turns, of all the factors behind these two processes, the most significant is arguably the fact that, and this is serious, the fact that entrenched and historic antagonisms between the sciences and humanities disciplines are breaking down. That is the event, if you want. They are breaking down as a result of a number of developments I would like to briefly single out. As we all know, the humanities have traditionally relied on two foundations. First has been the belief that humans somewhat occupy a unique position in the scheme of things. The humanities wouldn't exist without that foundational credo. That's the act of faith. I mean, it is really an act of faith. The act of faith, the foundational act of faith at the basis of the humanities as a series of disciplines is the belief that humans occupy a unique position in the scheme of things, that they are capable of rational thought, they have a capacity to feel emotions, that they, among the various species which populate the earth, they are endowed with agency, intentionality, and this is where lies the uniqueness of human nature. These are the articles of faith without which the humanities do not exist. So, second, that has been the first foundation. The second has been a clear distinction between society and nature, culture and nature. And this has been reflected historically in the division of labor between the social sciences on the one hand and the natural sciences on the other. Today, it is widely recognized that we humans are not as special as we once thought. We are not as special as we once thought, nor are we disentangled from other species as we once thought. That in fact, the future of our species will thoroughly depend on what we do to other species. So basically, the pillars are crumbling down. What we have believed so far, we can no longer believe in it. We do no longer believe in it. And therefore, the very existence of the humanities as a set of disciplines separate from everything else, that is what is at stake. So, how do we decolonize knowledge in the aftermath of that realization is something that has to be taken seriously by the proponents of the decolonization project. If they do not take it seriously, they will be speaking somewhat in the void. They won't be addressing what today are the key questions that are posed not only to those of us who work in Africa, but also to others who work in Europe, America, and the rest of the planet. So, what is called today the ontological turn has given rise to, of course, new subfields, mentioned a number of them, post-humanist ethnography, multi-species ethnography, environmental philosophy and history, earth science, earth system science, and other strands of social science research. Now, common to these subfields is the idea of distributed agency, and more fundamentally, the rejection of the dichotomy between subject and object, society and nature, human and non-human, living and non-living entities. And as a result of the collapse of these distinctions, there is a renewed dialogue going on between the social sciences, studies of science and technology, life and biological sciences, and philosophy. Of course, this dialogue is not without tensions and contradictions, yet issues that have primarily been the subject and object of the life and biological sciences are in different ways increasingly becoming the subject of theories and methods within the humanities and vice versa. So the point I'm making is that humanities-inflected inquiries are being reshaped in ways which make them more open to biological sciences just at the time when life and biological sciences are becoming more receptive to the social sciences. So what we are witnessing is an incipient convergence which has triggered entirely new research agendas, most of which privilege other foundational categories. No longer the human is unique in the scheme of things, but categories such as co-constitution, that we can't think of us without thinking at the same time of others, co-evolution, co-implication, categories which emphasize the processual, indeterminate, contingent, non-linear, relational nature of phenomena, constantly open to effects from contiguous processes, to use that kind of heavy jargon. So that is what is going on, part of what is going on. Now, there's another set of transformations. I will just mention them to make sure that we all understand what is at stake. And this one has to do with the neuroturn, neurology, neuroturn, and the risk of annexation of key categories of the humanities by the life sciences. That in fact, I mean, if you want to think in terms of what we thought was ours is being taken away from us by other disciplines which are dealing with it in ways which seem to speak more plausibly to the broader publics than we. That is what the neuroturn is doing. What's going on is that the many facets of human life that were, for much of the 20th century, primarily understood through the abstraction of culture or society, are increasingly understood as functions of the cerebral architecture of individuals, of group of individuals. In fact, the webs of human social and cultural life that we had come to understand as our particular object of knowledge seem more and more open to being figured neuroscientifically and experimentally. Neuroscientists are now seeking to establish the neural mechanisms that underpin almost every single human activity or emotion. So we cannot keep going on as if this was not happening. Now, the changes I have referred to are not only affecting how human beings are understood in the present, they are also affecting the very forms of knowing and the subject of knowledge. What is it I mean by this? This I mean that we do have now, thanks to progress in disciplines such as cognitive biology, we do have a far better and, I would say, more complex understanding of human cognitive ecology. And here, two or three quick points. First of all, we now know that cognition is not limited to humans or to organisms with consciousness. For a long time, that was the agreement, that cognition is limited to humans or organisms with consciousness. Now we know that cognition extends to all life forms, including those lacking central nervous systems, such as plants and microorganisms. That's the first thing. Second, cognition is also pervasive in complex technical systems. In other words, humans and living organisms are not the only important or relevant cognizers on the planet. Technical systems are also endowed, and in fact, more and more, with cognitive capabilities, some of which surpass human capabilities. And thirdly, knowledge does not only reside in the brain, it is also acquired through interactions with the environment. And all of this is happening amid a return to what we could call big questions, most of which have to do with what constitutes human life, and more importantly, with whether there is anything we hold dear in our ways of living that we might want to preserve, that we might want to nurture and foster while overcoming the existential paradigm that has set us on a fast track to ecological collapse. All that is coming, all these debates opened up by the Anthropocene. So I wanted to make those comments so that we have a clear understanding of what is at stake. But there's something else that is even more at stake, and I would like to look into it now before I conclude the presentation. Something else that is at stake, which has to do with knowledge in a computational age. It is not only the entire knowledge ecology that is fast changing, it is also what actually counts as knowledge. So that when we say we want to decolonize knowledge, we know exactly what we are talking about. What are we talking about? What counts as knowledge in a computational age? This is a very important question because the big cultural idea of our times is the conflation of the mind and the brain with a computer. And we are not going to go back. The conflation of the mind and the brain with a computer is our future. Of course, I mean, we still have traditional understandings of knowledge as tied to the requisite of empirical validation. But the epoch we live in is clearly in search for deterministic models of human behavior and decision making. Knowledge more and more lies or is reduced to an understanding of what lies behind people's decision making and their behavior. That the concept of knowledge we are working with now, from now on, is becoming more and more contracted and reduced precisely to the knowledge of what makes people behave and act the way they do. It is a conception of knowledge that claims to possess laws that can be discovered through the use of mathematics. But all of this is going on because clearly the 21st century knowledge landscapes will be defined by the digital computer. And knowledge will be more and more defined and understood as knowledge for the market. The market itself is currently reimagined as an information processor, as the primary mechanism for the validation of truth. So truth, the market is the truth. That's where the age we are entering it. The age Benjamin talked about in his fragments, capitalism as religion, when capital becomes a religion. So one of the big changes we are facing in terms of what counts for knowledge is that information processing is fast becoming the new orthodoxy. And in fact, all natural sciences are nowadays sciences of information in one form or another. Statistical inferences are all that count, and the latter can be derived from computation. In this context, one understands the contempt for the disciplines of the humanities, justified by their inability to adapt to market design. They have nothing to sell. The belief is that there's nothing they produce that can be mapped onto a market design. So what we are entering into is an essentially anti-humanist age, which has become a major feature of our present. At a time when, as I intimated, a new kind of human being is in the making, a human being which is constituted through and within digital technologies and computational media. And this is not at all the liberal individual whom not so long ago we believed could be the subject of democracy. Why? Because the computational age, the age of new media forms, is dominated by the idea that they are clean slates in the unconscious. To some extent, new media forms are the new infrastructures of the unconscious. What they have done is that they have lifted the lid previous cultural eras had put on the unconscious. I say all of this because yesterday, human sociality consisted in keeping a tab on the unconscious. There was no society without some kind of lead on the unconscious, without some kinds of originary taboos and distinctions. A human was not supposed to be an object, a human wasn't an animal, the taboo of incest, the taboo about murder, and many such distinctions that made civilization possible. That civilization, fundamentally, was that labor put in keeping the unconscious under some form or the other of control. So what we are witnessing, which is propelled by the new technological age we are entering in, is the lifting of all those taboos. And we are exiting the period when, for the social to thrive at all, meant exercising vigilance on ourselves or delegating to specific authorities the right to enforce such vigilance. This was called repression, but such repression was absolutely essential to pave the way for practices of sublimation. Freud talks about this a lot in his study of literature, for instance. Now, partly thanks to new media forms and the post-repressive era it unleashes, the unconscious can now roam free, almost unattached. A sublimation is no longer required. Language itself has been dislocated. The content is in the form, and the form is beyond or in excess of the content. We are led to believe that mediation is no longer necessary. Direct, originary experience is the new norm, all of which feeds into the growing anti-humanist stance I have referred to. Now, what are the implications of all of this for the study of Africa? I would like to end the presentation there. Let me just, here I'll be very telegraphic. The fact is that Africa is going through a silent techno-computational revolution. That is the fact. I can give you all kinds of figures, most of which it is a reality that is better captured, in fact, by people who really work with real money. It's not a fact that we academics are taking seriously, but it's a fact that is taken absolutely seriously by capital. The belief being that Africa is the last frontier of capitalism. It's not simply that electronic and digital footprints are everywhere in the continent. And this is not a matter only for rich people. In fact, in a place such as Johannesburg, where I live and work, it has become a matter of survival, including for the urban poor. At the moment you have, even before you have a shelter, even at times before you have food, the first priority is to be connected, because of the belief that everything else will accrue from, hopefully, from your being connected. So you get connected, eventually you have a television set, preferably cable television. So here then, like everywhere else in the world, life behind screens is fast becoming a fact of daily experience. It follows that as the boundaries of perception are being outstretched, because that is part of what this techno-revolution is accomplishing, more and more Africans are projected from one temporal regime into another. Time now unfolds in multiple versions. So, when you say decolonizing knowledge, what understanding of time temporality are you working with? When indeed time is unfolding in multiple versions, when its shapes are protean, more protean than they have ever been, and when the struggles to capture these protean shapes of time have hardly been documented, I could bring here the example of the cell phone. I'm sure that you are all familiar with it. But the argument I really want to end with is that the plasticity of digital forms, which we are witnessing, speaks powerfully to the plasticity of African pre-colonial cultures. It speaks very powerfully to ancient ways of working with representation and mediation, of folding reality. Because African pre-colonial cultures were obsessed by the interrogation concerning the boundaries of life, as evidenced by their myths, oral literatures, cosmogonies. Among the most important human queries were those concerning the world beyond human perceptibility, visibility, and consciousness. The time of objects was not unlike the time of humans. Objects were not seen as static entities. Rather, they were like flexible living beings endowed with original and at times occult and even therapeutic properties. And things and objects, the animal and organic worlds, were also repositories of energy, vitality, and virtuality. And as such, they constantly invited wonder and enchantment. Tools, technical objects, and artifacts also facilitated the capacity for human cognition and language. They belonged, in fact, to the world of interfaces, and as such, served as the linchpin to transgress existing boundaries so as to access the universe's infinite horizons. This is what early anthropologists mistook for animism. Turning now to knowledge, which is about to end, as such, it must be said that pre-colonial African ways of knowing have been particularly difficult to fit into Western analytical vocabularies. According to Jane Geyer, in her famous study of equatorial knowledge, such ways of knowing were not specialist in the sense of, quote, a closed esoteric system with its classifications and propositions, nor were they controlled and monopolized by a small cadre of experts or a secret society hierarchy. Collectively, she tells us, knowledge was conceptualized as an open repertoire and unbounded vista. Then, I'm still quoting her, within collectivities, the vista was divided up and quite widely distributed on the basis of personal capacity. Adepts were many and varied, she says, each pushing up against the outside limits of their own frontier of the known world, inventing new ways of configuring, storing, and using what must have been an ever-shifting spectrum of possibility. I'm quoting all of this as I'm trying to pivot now and give a space to the possibility of a decolonizing project that would not simply be the equivalent of a compensatory act. I'm trying to pivot now to suggest that we can indeed take shares in the project of decolonization, decolonizing knowledge, but at the condition of going through the demanding labor of coming up with a theory of knowledge. That's why I'm calling upon the work of Jane Geyer, and in this regard, of course, there are many others who have worked on this matter. Something like that is possible. One last thing Jane says in that piece is that which I find absolutely important, especially in regard to the times we live in which knowledge for the market is all that counts. She refers to these equatorial societies, which, following Jan van Sina and James Fernandez, she qualifies as societies which knew much more about their local habitats than they needed to know for utilitarian purposes, which means that knowledge for the sake of knowledge was a key feature of social existence. And knowledge was sought for its own sake. These were societies deeply open to novelty, who were willing to capture knowledge from wherever it came from. So if we take this seriously, then seems to me that these societies would hardly care about questions such as the decolonization of knowledge, that they would rather care about how to capture existing knowledge in order to foster innovation. Is it possible, then, to imagine a project of decolonization of knowledge that could rest precisely on some of these features? Let's hope so, and thank you very much.
So we would like to present Achille Mbembe with a plaque and a gift from the African Studies Association to thank him for that very provocative talk. I'd like to remind all of you that the award ceremony and the dance, indeed appetizers and refreshments are already being served now outside the Thurgood Marshall Ballroom, and then we'll go in and the award ceremony officially starts at 7:30. So I look forward to seeing you all then. Thank you.